From the JAMA Network, this is JAMA Clinical Reviews, interviews and ideas about innovations in medicine, science, and clinical practice.
Hello, and welcome to this JAMA Clinical Reviews podcast. I'm your host, Dr. Karen Lasser, Professor of Medicine at Boston University and Senior Editor at JAMA. Today, I am joined by Dr. Pavel Kolkhir, who is Head of Real World Research and of the Chronic Spontaneous Urticaria Program at the Institute of Allergology, Charité Medical University, Berlin. Welcome, Dr. Kolkhir, to this JAMA Clinical Reviews podcast.
Thank you for having me.
But before we get started, I know you would like to say a few words about Dr. Marcus Maurer.
Yes, actually, I would like to mention that this review was only made possible thanks to Professor Marcus Maurer, who is a leading expert in urticaria research and also my friend and my mentor, who, to much sadness, went missing on his vacation a few weeks ago.
Yeah, I was so sorry to hear that. Thank you so much. Now, let's talk about the topic that was Dr. Maurer's passion and lifelong work. To begin with, what is chronic spontaneous urticaria? And can you talk about the epidemiology?
Yes, chronic spontaneous urticaria, it's, of course, chronic disease, inflammatory disease, often autoimmune skin disease, which is more than 6 weeks duration. And in majority of patients, more than 3 to 5 years. Also characterized by spontaneously appearing wheals, which are superficial skin swellings, which are usually very itchy. Also angioedema, which is deep swelling of the dermis. And there are also some patients who can have both wheals and angioedema. As for epidemiology, so statistically, about 1% of general population has chronic spontaneous urticaria. So I would say that around every fifth person will experience at least one episode of any type of urticaria, including chronic spontaneous urticaria, during their life. So it's quite common. And the prevalence is increasing. And so the most common presentation would be wheals with or without angioedema. And there are also patients who have only isolated angioedema, so angioedema without wheals. But isolated angioedema is seen in about only 5 to maybe 10% of all patients with chronic spontaneous urticaria.
Excellent. Now, to clarify, in primary care, when we see patients with urticaria or hives that last less than 6 weeks, that would be acute. And 6 weeks or longer, it would be the chronic spontaneous urticaria. Is that correct?
I would say that 6 weeks or less, it will be acute. And more than 6 weeks, it will be chronic spontaneous.
That's very helpful. And what conditions are in the differential diagnosis of chronic spontaneous urticaria?
So this is actually a very interesting question, a very important one. There are several conditions that we need to take into account when we deal with the patients with chronic spontaneous urticaria. I would say that maybe most important three of them. The first one is urticarial vasculitis, which is characterized by long-lasting wheals with residual signs and symptoms like bruising and hyperpigmentation. These patients also often have systemic symptoms, for example, fever or joint pain. And the response to treatment is usually poor. Response to antihistamines, the first line of treatment of chronic spontaneous urticaria. The second main differential diagnosis of chronic spontaneous urticaria is autoinflammatory disease, such as, for example, Schnitzler syndrome, which is characterized by bone pain, also chronic urticarial rash, of course, and fever. And the last one, I would say, would be isolated angioedema, but in contrast to patients with chronic spontaneous urticaria, so isolated angioedema in context of chronic spontaneous urticaria, there is also isolated angioedema, which can last very long for 2 to 5 days and do not respond to antihistamines and omalizumab. So this urticaria guideline recommended treatments. And these patients also usually have some family members with isolated angioedema. And we talk about hereditary angioedema. And also there are some patients who have similar angioedema, similar to hereditary angioedema. And this angioedema is usually appears in patients who take in angiotensin-converting enzyme inhibitor.
Thank you. And I want to go back to a term you used in your response, which was autoinflammatory disease. Is that the same as autoimmune disease, or is that something different?
No, this is actually a different condition. So in patients with autoinflammatory disease or autoinflammatory syndromes, we usually do not see autoantibodies, which we frequently see in patients with autoimmune diseases. And in some of these patients, or in many of them, we can also perform skin biopsy and we see a lot of neutrophils in the skin. And patients with autoinflammatory syndromes, they usually do not have autoimmune diseases. In contrast to patients with autoimmune diseases, which actually very often have other autoimmune diseases. For example, chronic spontaneous urticaria is also autoimmune disease. And patients with chronic spontaneous urticaria, especially with autoimmune type, they also very often have other autoimmune diseases, for example, Hashimoto's thyroiditis.
Mm-hmm. Now, which laboratory tests should be checked for patients who present with chronic spontaneous urticaria?
So actually, the basic laboratory investigation includes common blood count with differential, erythrocyte sedimentation rate, and or C-reactive protein. And these tests would be important for several reasons. First of all, if we see, for example, elevated levels of C-reactive protein, we can think about some underlying cause of chronic spontaneous urticaria, for example, infection. And these tests can also help and give some hints for possible autoimmune endotype of chronic spontaneous urticaria. For example, if we see low eosinophil counts and basophil counts in the common blood count of a patient with chronic spontaneous urticaria, this point to possible autoimmune endotype of chronic spontaneous urticaria.
And can you tell our listeners what you mean by endotype?
Endotype means underlying mechanism. So this is actually a very exciting topic because just maybe several years ago, we didn't know so much about these autoimmune endotypes. And now we know much more. So we know that there are two types of autoimmune reactions which can appear in patients with chronic spontaneous urticaria. So the first type is called type 1 autoimmune chronic spontaneous urticaria or autoallergic chronic spontaneous urticaria, which is associated with production of IgE autoantibodies against internal autoallergens or autoantigens, in contrast to, for example, to allergy, when IgE produced against external allergens. And these complexes, IgE autoantibodies and against these autoantigens like thyroid peroxidase or interleukin-24, these complexes can activate mast cells with the production of histamine and symptoms of urticaria. And we also have so-called type 2B autoimmune CSU, which is associated with IgG autoantibodies. And these IgG autoantibodies will be produced against IgE or high-affinity IgE receptors on mast cells and basophils. And these complexes can also cross-link and activate mast cells and basophils with development of urticaria symptoms.
Thank you. Now, when a generalist encounters a patient with chronic spontaneous urticaria, do we need to be concerned about food allergies, for example, and do testing for food allergies?
So actually, food allergy is rare, or I would say even extremely rare, cause of chronic spontaneous urticaria. Some patients report that food can exacerbate their urticaria. So actually, in the past, there are so many different investigations were performed to try to find a cause of chronic spontaneous urticaria, usually in vain. And in majority of patients, urticaria was defined as without any known cause or idiopathic. And now we know much more about underlying causes, actually what we already talked about these autoimmune CSU endotypes.
Mm-hmm. And earlier you mentioned checking a common blood count. I don't know if there's a difference in terminology in Europe. Is that the same as a complete blood count?
Yes, it's the same.
Okay, thanks. Now, what is first-line treatment for patients with chronic spontaneous urticaria, and how effective is it?
The first-line treatment in patients with chronic spontaneous urticaria is second-generation antihistamines, and the treatment goal is complete disease control, and so treat the disease until it is gone, and we start with antihistamines in lysine dose. They are usually helpful in about, I would say, 8% of patients. So 8% of patients show complete disease control with lysine dose of antihistamines. And then we can increase off-label, we can increase up to 4 times the maximum approved dose with maybe 5 or 4% of patients showing complete disease control on up-dosed second-generation antihistamines.
And these are the H1 antihistamines, correct?
Yes, exactly. So we're talking about second-generation H1 antihistamines.
Excellent. And when should patients be referred to a dermatologist or an allergist?
Well, an easy answer would be anytime you're feeling uncomfortable managing a patient with chronic spontaneous urticaria, please refer this patient to a specialist. In particular, for example, when a patient reports about the wheals for more than 24 hours duration, we need to rule out urticular vasculitis. When we see a patient with long-lasting isolated angioedema without wheals, we need to exclude hereditary angioedema. Then it's also a reason to refer. When we see a patient with systemic symptoms like fever, arthralgia, abdominal pain, in addition to wheals, then we can also refer this patient to a specialist to exclude urticular vasculitis or autoinflammatory disease. We have not talked about this yet, but there are some patients with chronic spontaneous urticaria who also have chronic inducible urticaria, where wheals and angioedema can appear due to external stimuli like cold or warm provocation. And here we need to perform provocation tests. And these provocation tests are not readily available in generalist office. So it might be also reason for refer to a specialized urticaria center. And finally, if you do not see a disease control with increased dosage of H1 antihistamines, it might be also a reason to refer a patient to a specialist to discuss any possible second and third line treatments.
Now, what are those second and third line treatments and how effective are they?
The second line treatment is omalizumab. It's a monoclonal antibody, IgE antibody. Actually, it's very effective in comparison to patients who received antihistamines in standard dose, in lysine dose, or up to 4 times the maximum approved dose. So patients who were treated with omalizumab, about 29% of them show complete disease control with omalizumab in comparison to patients on antihistamines, only 7%. It's also safe long-term, and some patients report some local reactions, but rather than that, there are actually no safety concerns. Of course, some anaphylactic reactions to omalizumab have been described in the literature, but they are quite rare. And if omalizumab does not help to reach the complete disease control, which is a goal of the treatment of chronic spontaneous urticaria, as Professor Mao always said, treat the disease until it is gone. So if we could not reach the disease control with omalizumab, then we can switch to the third line treatment, which is actually cyclosporine A. It's immunosuppressant. It might be especially helpful in patients with chronic spontaneous urticaria with this autoimmune endotype. But cyclosporine has some known adverse effects such as renal dysfunction and high blood pressure. So these patients, they should be monitored, I would say. But soon we won't be limited only to these three treatment options. There will be more. And I hope that in the future we'll have something for each patient with chronic spontaneous urticaria because there are some promising novel therapies which will appear soon.
And are steroids ever indicated in this condition?
As for steroids, this is a very important point. Actually, steroids should not be used for more than 10 days. And even if they used in a patient with chronic spontaneous urticaria, they should be used short-term and only in a patient with acute severe exacerbation of chronic spontaneous urticaria.
Thank you. And how does chronic spontaneous urticaria affect patients' quality of life? And what are some of the associated comorbidities?
Actually, chronic spontaneous urticaria considerably affects a patient's quality of life. So if we take, for example, DLQI, it's a disease life quality index, about 40% of patients with chronic spontaneous urticaria have DLQI score 10 or more, which corresponds to a significant or extremely significant impact on the patient quality of life. And there are also some comorbidities which can contribute to a further decrease in quality of life. For example, some mental health disorders such as anxiety or depression. And these diseases can also appear due to urticaria itself. And they can be induced by, for example, symptoms, urticaria symptoms, such as very severe itch and also angioedema.
And what is the overall prognosis for people with chronic spontaneous urticaria?
So this is a good question. About 45-50% of patients have spontaneous remission at 5 years. But unfortunately, it relapses in about 1/3 of all patients.
Thank you. Now, is there anything else generalists should know about chronic spontaneous urticaria that we haven't talked about?
Yes. So a simplistic answer would be avoid extensive investigation to identify a cause of chronic spontaneous urticaria. Because, as we already discussed, many patients have this autoimmune chronic spontaneous urticaria. When we need to look for a cause of chronic spontaneous urticaria, if a patient reports, for example, about any symptoms beyond Wills angioedema, and if we have some hints from the basic laboratory investigation, then we can order additional investigations. This can be also a reason to refer a patient to a specialist. And you can also tell patients that chronic spontaneous urticaria is not a life-threatening disease. It's rarely allergic. It's often occurs due to autoimmune reactions and usually results within several years. And we need always remember that we need to treat the disease until it is gone, as Professor Mao said, with so little medication as possible.
Thank you so much. This has been so helpful. I'm Dr. Karen Lasser. I've been speaking today with Dr. Pavel Kolkhir from Charité Medical University Berlin about chronic spontaneous urticaria. You can find a link to the article in this episode's description. To follow this and other JAMA Network podcasts, please visit us online at jamanetworkaudio.com or search for JAMA Network wherever you get your podcasts. This episode was produced by Daniel Musisi at the JAMA Network. Thanks for listening.